Tonight, I start a brand new series. Yeah, I like this. This is good. And my last series inspired it. I've been doing this series on the weekends called The Writings. Tonight, I'm going to start. I don't know how long we'll go. It'll be somewhere between 3 and 39 weeks. But tonight, we're going to begin to talk about the power of God's Word. I want you to know about the power, the miracle-working power of the Word of God. And so we're going to take this thing about the writings and the Word of God in the Bible even further. And I'm telling you, on Wednesday nights can transform your life if you'll pick up some of these principles we're going to show you from the Bible. We'll get as far as we can get tonight in 22 minutes, because tonight I'm going to do an 8 o'clock cutoff so we can know we can do it. Because the office people are making me. All right, let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for this time together. And bless the reading and the study of God's Word. Lord, change our lives tonight by your Spirit and by your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, if you will, turn with me quickly to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. We're going to talk about the power of God's Word. The power of God's Word. Hebrews 4:12. I've quoted this a couple of times in our recent series on the writings. We finished that, by the way. We start our new series called Bible Stories 2. It's telling stories every weekend. Stories that'll transform our life from the Bible, from the Word of God. So we've been talking about the Bible. We're going to continue to talk from the Bible. We always teach the Bible, of course, but I'm working real hard to cultivate your faith in the book itself, the writings themselves, the scriptures themselves, the Word of God itself. Now, we worship Jesus, and Jesus is our Savior. And thank God, God sent His Son, but He also left His book. And this book is a supernatural book. It's a miracle-working book. And it is a book that is full of power, supernatural, miracle-working, God-impacting power. Power. I believe the Holy Spirit has power. I also believe the Word of God. God's Spirit has power. God's Word has power. And so we're going to study that, the transforming, miracle-working power of the Word of God. And I quoted this verse a couple of times. I want you to look at it. We're just looking at the first little third part of the verse. And this is our master text for this entire series of studies. Hebrews 4:12. For the Word of God is quick and powerful. The Word of God is quick and powerful. Of course, that's Old English. That's King James English. The word quick there doesn't mean fast. No. It means alive. And so it should read like this. The Word of God is alive and powerful. Say that with me. The Word of God is alive and powerful. Quick is an Old English word meaning alive. You know, when you cut your fingernails a little bit too closely, you cut them down into the quick, that's that living, alive part, and it hurts. Why? Because it's alive. All right? So when he says the Word of God is quick, he means it's alive. The word there is zeo, and it means alive. Get this, living, breathing, active, and blessed. So I want to quote it like that. The Word of God is alive, living, breathing, active, and blessed. And by blessed, I don't just mean it's special. I mean there's a blessing upon it from Almighty God Himself. The word blessing means to benefit. It is a benefited book that will benefit your life. It's a beneficial power in your life, the Word of God. So He says the Word of God is alive, it's living, it's breathing. Think about it, it's breathing. The writer of Hebrews treats the Word of God as a living, breathing entity, a living, breathing thing. You're alive. God's alive. This book is alive. It's a living book. It's not a dead letter. It's a living book. Many times different people and different denominations and movements and segments of the Christian faith have allowed it to become a dead letter to them, but I'm telling you, the Word of God is not dead. It is alive. It is breathing. It is active. In other words, It's acting all the time. It's influencing all the time. It's affecting all of the time. You can't read the true word of God to people without it affecting them, positively or negatively. It thrills some people. It chills other people. It makes some people happy and some people angry. It saves, it damns. It's a two-edged sword, but it's powerful. It's powerful. You say, well, I don't want it to damn me. I want it to save me. Then get your attitude straight. Oh, yeah, we make the choice of whether we're damned or saved. Jesus said that in Mark, the 16th chapter. He said, he that believeth what? Believes this word. He that believes the gospel, he that believes the word of God and acts upon it, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned or condemned or judged. And so it's all in our receptivity or lack thereof. It's all in our attitude. It's all in whether we decide to believe it or to not believe it. And this may be a little blunt, and I don't mean to offend anybody right off the bat. This is only number one, but I'm going to go ahead and say it. You either believe it or you don't believe it. And you can say, I believe the Bible, I believe it's the Word of God, and yet fail to believe a promise of it and fail to receive the best that God wants for you because you don't actively believe it at a specific point of time when you need to believe a specific promise from God. Doesn't mean you don't believe the Bible, just means you're not believing the promise for your situation right now. How many of you know you can believe the Bible and yet not believe the promise of God you need to put you over in life? You can fail to enter in like the Jews, the Hebrews says. Book of Hebrews says they fail to enter in because of their unbelief. And yet they believed in God. Some people think if they just believe in God, that does everything. It doesn't. You know, the Bible says demons believe and tremble because they know their end. They know their future. And so there's believing and then there's believing. There's believing in general and there's believing in specific. And there's believing in God and there's believing in the Bible. And then there's believing what God told you and believing what God told you to do and believing what God has promised you. And I want to help you. I want to funnel you toward specifically, absolutely, actively believing God's specific promises for your life so that they will go to work in your life, transforming your life and performing the miracles God wants to happen in your life. Does that make sense? The Word of God is alive and living and breathing and active and it's blessed. And then he says, and it's powerful. I like to say it like this. It's powerful. It's full of power. That word, that's a great Greek word, the word powerful. It's the Greek word energēs. The root of it is from the Greek and then through the Latin and through Europe and then to Britain and the English language. And we get our word energy from this word. Energēs became our English word energy. He says the Word of God is alive and it's, you could say, energetic or full of energy. How many of you know energy? You need some energy to function in your daytime, right? He said the Word of God is alive and it's powerful or full of energy, or literally it is active, operative, effective, and powerful. Let me say those. This is what the word means. It is active, operative, effective, and powerful. Let me tell you something. This word that God has spoken and that the prophets and apostles have written and has been protected and guarded and brought down to our generation, it is a living, breathing document filled with the life of God Himself. And it is powerful and effective and active and operative. In other words, it'll work. It will work. Listen, the word works when you put it to work in your life. If you leave it on a shelf or leave it out of your heart or leave it out of your mouth or leave it out of your mentality, it's not going to do much. But well, you internalize this word, you put this word in your heart that you might not sin against God and your life is about to change. You put this word in your mouth, speaking it like a sword, your enemy is about to be defeated. I'm telling you, the Word of God is alive and full of power, and it'll do some great things in your life. See, we're already happy, and we've only got the first verse. That's how powerful this book is. I mean, you could come in here all down in the mully grubs and go out here with a new lease on life, ready to conquer the world. You came in, a greasy spot on the floor, but you leave. I'm going to conquer the world. His word is working in me. Yeah? Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. That's the way we ought to live. Now, I know the Living Bible is just a paraphrase. It's not a strict, accurate translation. But I kind of like what the old Living Bible, the way it translates or paraphrases this verse. Listen to the Living Bible. It says this, "For whatever God says to us is full of living power." Wow. Whatever God says to us is full of living power. Turn back in the Bible to the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. If I got time, I want to give you four truths tonight just to start and introduce this subject. I guess I just gave you about eight or nine truths right there, but I want to give you four major points tonight. If I can get and if I don't, we had to cut it off. We'll just unhook from the train car we drop off tonight. Pick it up next week. It'll be all right. I didn't say that right, but you get the point. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. In the Hebrew, it could mean chaotic. It was utter chaos. By the way, the whole Bible is about God bringing order out of chaos. It starts out with chaos. And if you read the last chapter of the book, you'll find order. Perfect order. Complete and perfect, beautiful order. God wants to take the chaos of our lives and bring it into divine order. And he does it through what he says to us. Watch this. He says, the earth was without form and it was in utter chaos, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Now, I don't have to read all down through the chapter. I think you're familiar with Genesis chapter 1. He said, let there be light, and there was light. He spoke the light into existence. Let there be light, and there was light. In the Hebrew, it could read like this. God said, light be, and light was. Wow. And then the following verses show how that God made mountains and seas and the fish and the animals and everything by the words of his mouth. In fact, the Bible teaches that everything in creation was created by the words of God. That's number one tonight. God created everything with his word. God created everything with his word. The substance that was taken, the materials that were taken to create that chair you're sitting on, all of the elements, all of that substance, all of those molecules and those atoms, whatever it took to construct the chair you're sitting on tonight, it was created by the Word of God. You were created by the Word of God. The metal that was used to build the car you drove here with was created by the Word of God, the utterance of God, by God speaking. And he began the whole process by saying, light be. Now, sometimes we say, well, this was the creation of light. It really is not. It didn't say that God created light there. It said God said, let there be light, and there was light. But I want to remind you that the same Bible also teaches that God is light. And how many of you know God's eternal? And so light has always been. I think this is important. It's not a sidetrack, not a bunny trail. Light has always been because God has always been, and God is light. John said that over in 1 John. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Right? So if God is light and God is eternal and God has always been, then light has always been. So what is this? I'll tell you what this is. This is God creating out of himself the world and the universe that we live in. God is light. And when God said, let there be light, I believe that he was digging deep down into the heart of hearts of his own nature, his character, his being. He was taking what he's filled with, what he is, his own nature, and he was pulling it out of himself and projecting it throughout all of the universe. When he said, light be, light was, because light came out of him, because he is light. And so everything about the creation is really an expression of God himself. That's why The heavens declare the glory of God. The heavens are lit up. They're ignited with the sparkles of God's own glory and His own nature. God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. But what I want you to see is God took something that was on the inside of Him, projecting it to the outside of Him, displaying it to bless the universe, to bless existence, to bless you and I today. He took what was on the inside of Him, expressed it toward the outside of Him, painted the skies with Himself. But the principle is, God took what was in His heart and spoke it out of His heart. And when He spoke what was in His heart and spoke it out of His heart, and those words came through His lips, His words were the power containers that imparted the godness of God, the light of God, the glory of God. It was no longer contained within God, but expressed on the outside of God, and it lit up the universe, and it framed the worlds. And the eons of time and all of creation started with God expressing His own nature and painting our universe with it. And that's why it's such an extremely sinful and wicked thing for any of God's creation to dirty, pervert, impede, attack, obstruct, tarnish, or contaminate what God has created. We've been made stewards over a wonderful, glorious creation, or at least our part of it. Everything from the lot you own that your house sits on, to the body you live in, to the job you have, the talent you've been given. It's all an expression of what's on the inside of God. You haven't got anything that God didn't give you, and that God did not originate, and that God did not create, or that God did not impart out of His own being. You know, people say, what's God ever done for me? You know how people get. What's God ever done? Oh, shut up. What's God ever done for you? There wouldn't be a yeah if it weren't for God. Come on, give the Lord a hand, God. There wouldn't be nothing without God. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God said, let there be light. Notice that God creates with His words. That's point number one. That's the first thing we're going to learn in this series. God created everything with His word. God created everything with His word. God created everything with His word. Everything that you can see, taste, touch, smell, everything that exists is a product of God's word, what God has said. It's all been spoken into existence. He didn't work His fingers to the bone for 48 hours to produce any of it. He spoke it into existence. It's all a product of God's word, what God has said. Everything that exists was created with His word. Now look at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2. The previous verse says, God hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son. See, Jesus is what God wants to say. God has spoken to us by His Son. You want to know what God says? Look at Jesus. In these last days, He's spoken to us by His Son. Spoken to us. God is a talker. He creates with His words. He created you with His words. And He wants to talk to you with His words. God has spoken unto us by His Son, whom He has appointed heir of all things, by whom also He made the worlds. Jesus was there, the second person of the Trinity, was there when everything was created. By whom also He made the worlds. Through Jesus Himself, He made the worlds. Jesus actually created the worlds. Jesus did, the second person of the Godhead. God the Father, by the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus, whom eventually we'll get to John chapter 1, where He's called the Word of, He's called the Word of God. It's His title. We'll talk about the significance of that. But He says that, by Him, by His Son, He has made the worlds. Who, talking about Jesus, who being the brightness of God's glory and the express image of His person. In other words, if you see Jesus, you've seen God. That's what He looks like. And, watch this, and upholding. Here's the part I want you to see. And upholding, Jesus upholding all things All things means everything. Jesus upholding all things by the word of his power. When he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Now, he gets into salvation, all that thing, all of those things. But here's the part I want you to see, that he says here, Jesus upholds everything, everything. And he created everything. And isn't that right? It says he made the worlds. And so he created all these things, and he's upholding all these things by the word of it. How did he create everything? By his words. How is he upholding everything? By his words. So here's number two. All creation is upheld and sustained by his word. It's not self-sustaining. His word sustains creation. His word sustains the universe. His word makes the moon orbit the earth. His word causes the earth to revolve around the sun. His word keeps the Milky Way together. His word sustains everything. Where did gravity come from? His word. That's the only reason you don't spin off and go flying through space, because God has said you're stuck to the earth with gravity. You ever notice gravity always works? You don't even have to believe in it. You jump off a building, it takes over. There are certain laws put into this natural world put in place. And the law of gravity always works unless you supersede it with another law, like the law of lift, which is what an airplane operates by. And it puts into motion the law of lift, which overcomes the law of gravity. So there are laws, there are things that work, and then there are other things that supersede those things that work. And that's why it's such a glorious thing when the New Testament says that the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has now made me free from the law of sin and death. You see, there's a law of sin and death that weights the human race down, down, down into sin. But now a new law has been introduced that supersedes the law of sin and death, and it's the law of God's grace and the law of God's salvation and the law of the Spirit of life in Christ. Jesus died and came alive again to give you a new law that supersedes sin. It's the law of righteousness, and we're living in that. And where did that come from? God spoke it into existence. He promised it for centuries, and then his word became flesh, and he dwelt among us, and Jesus came, the very word of God, speaking a word that liberates us from the laws, the natural laws of this world. Everything, here's the point I want to make. Everything God does, he does it with his words. And I want to deliver you from something. I want to get you out of this. Oh, I'm just going to go to church. It's my filling station. And I just need to go and feel God. You don't need to feel God. You need to hear God. If you never felt him for 10 years, you can open your Bible and hear him. Feelings come and go. Feelings are only designed for one purpose, to tell you how you feel. And that changes. But the word of the Lord lives forever. And it's always true. It's always true. All creation is upheld and sustained by his word. Stand with me. I got to quit. I'm already a minute late. I got to get out. Say this with me. God created everything with his word. All creation is upheld and sustained by his word. How many of you would like to come back next week and find out what else can happen with his word when it's introduced into creation? That's what we're going to talk about. That's what we're going to talk about. Because God can speak a word in this creation, make a miracle happen, and make a miracle happen for you. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your scriptures, the writings of the Bible, the word of God that's alive and full of power. Help us to learn about it and let it transform our very lives. We're created by your word. Lord, transform us by your word so that we can be like Jesus. We believe you for it in his name. Amen. 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 Thanks, guys. God bless you. Have a good night.